Great. Welcome to the College of Complexes. My name is Don, and I'm going to be the moderator this evening. Our speaker tonight is the Reverend Dr. Terry Gallagher. He is the chair of the Environmental Task Force Illinois Conference of the United Church of Christ. He's going to be talking about COP21, a tale of two conferences. This is an acronym that stands for Conference of the Parties, and it's called COP21 because it's the 21st meeting of the Conference of the Parties. This was an international conference that had to do with climate change. Now, formerly known as global warming. Let's have a warm round of applause for our speaker this evening, the Reverend Dr. Terry Gallagher.
Yay!
Okay.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
You are here, right?
Yeah.
I know I'm fighting stomachs right now, so it's always a challenge. I wanted to give you a quick brief background on who's talking to you right now, because it might seem a little weird. I'm a bit of an odd duck. I was educated originally as an engineer. I spent 30 plus years in the chemical industry as an engineer and as a plant manager of highly hazardous chemical plants before I took this strange left turn into ministry. I've been in ministry for 10 years now. The last 4 years, my ministry has been devoted to ecological justice as we care and try to awaken people around the globe to our destruction of the earth and the earth systems. I do about 50 presentations a year, both faith-based and secular, like tonight. But I also do lobbying on Capitol Hill and in the state capitol. I testify before energy committees and the EPA, because apparently there's a shortage of pastors that used to be chemical plant managers. I don't know. And then I also participate in street actions and protests. I don't know if anybody took part in the BP refinery demonstration we had about a month ago.
Yeah.
We had a few hundred people turn out for that. It was good. So anyway, I
fell asleep.
The presentation for tonight, we're going to get into the Conference of the Parties, which is COP21, as was explained to you. 21 meaning that it took them 21 times coming together before they accomplished anything, and we'll talk about that. What I want to talk about first is what's holding us back? What's keeping our society from embracing the scientific truth? This is not new science. The science of global warming or climate change, whatever. The science that if you put CO2 and methane up in the air is going to heat up the earth is about 125 years old. That's not new science. In the 1950s, there was such a concern that they permanently established a daily measurement of the CO2 up in the atmosphere in Hawaii. In the 1980s, the concern had grown so much that we had scientists testifying in front of Congress that it was not only projected, but they could measure it happening now. The very first president that said we're going to be in trouble if we keep burning fossil fuels, anybody got a guess?
Jimmy Carter.
Lyndon Baines Johnson.
Oh.
50 years ago. 51 years ago. So this is not new. Not at all. So what's keeping us from doing something about it? And I want to talk about storytelling. We're people of stories. Stories inform our lives. They give us values. They tell us what makes for a good life and what makes for a bad life. They tell us who to listen to and who not to listen to. They tell us who to go to war with and who to make peace with. They tell us who is fully human and who is not. Stories begin, my youngest granddaughter has just turned one, and she's already picking up stories while being in the embrace of her mom or her dad. So we start stories, we start bringing them into our lives at a very early age. We get affected by the stories we learn in our families, in our neighborhoods, in our schools, in our workplaces, in our restaurants and colleges that we belong to. Stories inform our lives. Stories also screen out what we don't want to hear. Those are the stories that we have to engage. If we grew up in different neighborhoods, we might have some different stories. I grew up on the west side of Cleveland, and so my stories are centered around the mistake on the lake and the river that catches on fire. Okay? You guys growing up around here are always, next year the Cubs are going to win. Okay?
Yeah.
So those are the stories there. But as a society, as a great society, as a national society, we have several stories that we subconsciously embrace, and sometimes we tell outright, that keeps us from doing something about it. And those three stories are, the earth is too big to hurt. That's the number one story. We embed this in our whole economic system. The earth is too big, it's too huge, it's just too vast. There's no way that simple human beings could possibly hurt the earth. And this is a story we tell ourselves in order to explain why millions of smokestacks and billions of exhaust pipes are okay. That's the story we tell ourselves that allow our daily lives centered in fossil fuel. The second story is built off of that, and it's kind of like it. The second story is there's always more. So no matter what you consume, there's always more. You don't need to worry about what we're consuming or that we should have limits. There's always more. That's the story of our marketplace. That's the story of 10,000 or 12,000 commercials you're going to hear today. There's always more. That's the story of our political system. You'll hear every candidate running for office, with the exception of maybe your friend. That'll tell you that the only thing you need is a little more growth. There's always more. It comes out of the American story of go west, young man, you'll find in your adventure out west, there's always more. The third story that keeps us from doing anything might be the most difficult story for us in America, the challenge. And that's the story of the supremacy of the individual. That the individual's rights, the individual wants, the individual desires trump every other need of society. That if I can spend the money for it, I deserve to have it, no matter what harm it causes. Super individualism is why we give billionaires hero status. That might be the hardest one for us to shed. But shed it we must if we're going to do something about a global problem of this size. So let's get started. Everybody remember this picture? Mm-hmm. Where'd you see it?
69.
69?
Yeah. Yeah.
Where from?
To the moon.
The first astronauts on the moon, taking a picture of it, beaming back to us, right? This should have defeated that first story. It was the first picture we had that showed how small, how fragile the Earth really is. This story should have been enough to challenge that story that the Earth is so big we can't hurt it. But we looked at this, we said ooh and ah, and we went on building more smokestacks and more exhaust pipes. The Earth is really a small, tender place. There's two huge things that have happened in my lifetime. The first one is we have tripled the human population. In my lifetime, we have tripled the human population. And every one of them wants to be like Mike. Every one of them wants to consume on the level that we consume at. And that's harming that Earth. The second thing is we built our Earth, our modern society, our economy, on fossil fuels. Dig it up out of the ground, burn it, throw it up in the air, nothing's gonna happen. You got oil executives right now that are paying millions of dollars to fight the idea that something is happening. So it's totally interwoven into our economy, and that's a big story of a fight. Okay, so the first major thing that happened in my lifetime that just blows the mind is we tripled the world population, but that's not the story. This is the story. In my lifetime, we've increased pollution sixfold. Sixfold. So maybe a few smokestacks back in 1950 just hurt the people that were around it. But the millions of smokestacks and the billions of exhaust pipes are killing people right now. The World Health Organization says that somewhere between 6 and 8 million people a year die from air pollution. Today, 6 to 8 million people a year. You know any kids that are using inhalers because of asthma? That's coming from the exhaust pipes. This is real. It's happening now. We know we have to change. If we have any objection at all, we know we have to change from what we're doing to the earth. We take a quick quote from the Pope. He says, many things we have to change course, but it's human beings above all who need to change. We've done some terrible things to the earth in our addiction to fossil fuels. But it's not just the warming of the earth. We're in the midst of a massive extinction. We lost more than half of the animals in my lifetime. 50% of all the species could be lost in a century. Amphibians who survived the last ice age are being killed, going extinct. There's no question that we're in the midst of a massive extinction spasm, a spasm that is happening at a rate 1,000 times faster than normal extinction happens. Anybody been following the news on the coral leaching that's going on because of the hot water? Two-thirds of the Great Barrier Reef is in danger of dying off. Other coral reefs around. We're depleting the fish and the mammals and the sea life of the seas. Humanity is collectively mismanaging the ocean to the brink of collapse. We're affecting the start of the food chain. And if you affect the start of the food chain, everybody up the food chain suffers from it. Our heating of the oceans and then polluting the waters with nitrogen and phosphorus from and sodium from our agricultural chemicals winds up having great huge algae blooms. You guys remember about 3 years ago, Toledo lost its drinking water for several days because of an algae bloom. Algae sucks all of the oxygen out of the water, kills all the fish life, but also creates a toxic, poisonous byproduct, waste that affects it. That's happening right now in the Gulf of Mexico. There's a dead spot in the Gulf of Mexico about the size of Connecticut. Anybody ever wonder where the mercury warnings came for fish? You know, pregnant women shouldn't have so many fish, shouldn't eat. That mercury comes from our smokestack. It's in the coal. A little bit of Genesis, that's all the Bible is going to give you then. Keep them alive with you. And Francis saying, if we destroy creation, creation destroys. So, the cost of our addiction to carbon, wildfires, floods, and species extinction, drought, storm damage, dying coral, infrastructure loss, climate refugees. Anybody been following what's been happening with the refugees going into Europe? It's really the first wave of climate refugees. Why do I say that? They're coming out of Syria for the most part. The Syria civil war started after an 11-year long drought. And during that drought, 50% of the farms in Syria went back to desert. They killed off 80% of the livestock. Millions of farmers had to go into the cities to try and find a living. The cities couldn't absorb it. WikiLeaks exposed a cable from their interior ministry to our State Department back in 2008 saying, we can't deal with this. We can't feed all of these hungry people. And when people get hungry, people get desperate. People do harsh things. That civil war has claimed a couple hundred thousand lives already. 10,000 lives alone have drowned in the Mediterranean in the last year trying to find a place that they can live and grow family. Anybody remember this?
Easter Island
at one point was covered with trees. But for some reason they got it in their heads that they needed to have these sculptures to ward off other tribes, to ward off invaders off the land. But to dig these stones and to carve them you had to harden tools, and you had to cut down trees to build the fires to harden the tools. And then they weigh so much, and they wanted to put them on the coast. They had to cut down more trees in order to roll them out on the coast. And before you knew it, all the trees were gone. And then they discovered you can't live without trees. And a question for us, are we going to be smarter as a society than Easter Island? If you look real quick, you're going to see me. Me and about 399,000 other friends walking there. Okay? That's New York City a couple years ago. We had the largest climate march on the globe. Okay? It's stunning. So let's get to COP21. COP21 is Conference of the Parties. It's a calling for all the international states, all the nations of the earth to come together to engage in discussion on climate change, on global warming, on what's causing it and what we need to do about it. 21 means it's the 21st time they've met, 21 years running. And up until now, this happened last December in Paris, I was there, nothing had happened. So I'm going to tell you a tale of two conferences. It was the best of conferences, it was the worst of conferences. Anybody remember that line? It was the best of, it was what's it from? The tale of worst. You guys are sharp tonight. Here, I thought I lost you in the spaghetti. So, 195 nations of the earth come together to meet for the 21st time on the crisis of global warming. We don't all come to the table with the same footprint. On a per capita basis, the U.S. 16.3 metric tons per person, China 6.9, India 1.7. So if you hear somebody complaining that India and China are the problem, they're speaking with four tongues. Bill McKibben was there. Anybody know Bill McKibben?
Yeah.
He's a great leader. He founded 350. He, along with six college kids, they each took one of the continents when they were started to start spreading. Anyway, he talked about that what was happening at that conference was the coming together of physics and poetry. That the physics of what we have done to the atmosphere is becoming so plainly obvious that we're destroying the earth that we live on, and yet we're not responding to it. And so maybe it'll take poetry, or what I say is storytelling, to appeal to us below, to somehow get us to move. This happened right after the terrorist attack in Paris. So 2 weeks before, 10 days before, there was the terrible terrorist attack in Paris, and Paris was on lockdown, martial law, public demonstrations were prohibited, and so what you see here are shoes for those who would have marched if they'd been given permission to call attention that we have to save the planet. So thousands and thousands of shoes filled this plaza, including the shoes of the President of France and the Secretary General of the UN. An artist had the idea to speak to us, to get to us, and he brought in icebergs. And he put them in front of the Historical Museum in Paris, so that we would have the concept of, as this conference was going on for 2 weeks, was the ice going to be all gone before human beings could agree on an answer? And so you could watch as the weeks went on, as the ice started to melt more and more. Outside the conference, there were visible actions to try and pressure the politics that was happening in the conference. So 350.org held a public trial of Exxon against humanity. They rented an empty warehouse, and they conducted a public trial. So Bill McKibben was there, Naomi Klein, you know her? She was there. Greenpeace, green, the arc to triumph, right? So the big arc of triumph, a war memorial in the center of Paris, the circular road that goes around it. They had guys in motorcycles that had paints in their boots, and they just spattered it out across that, and cars painted around so that the whole plaza became green. Then there was the process that couldn't be stopped. Even though protests were against martial law with the threat that everybody was going to be incarcerated forever, at the end of the conference, before the conference came to completion, the activist groups told the government of France, there's going to be a march, you're going to have to arrest tens of thousands of people. And so the government of France decided, well, on this one occasion, we'll let a march happen. There's pictures from the trial, Exxon versus the people. This has come back to the United States, by the way. 17 attorney generals are suing Exxon for their crimes against humanity in keeping the science away and distorting it. There's the march that they couldn't stop. Thousands of people marching on the Arc of Triumph. Okay. So, the conference itself, it came down to two words and two numbers. So, the words are shall or should, and the numbers are 2 degrees or 1.5 degrees Celsius. What's the big deal? Shouldn't be a big deal, right? No. The nations of the earth have come together 20 times before, 20 different times, annual conference, and they never could agree, and on this one, they did agree. But there are limitations to what they agreed to. The first thing that shocked everybody is the mention of 1.5 degrees centigrade, because going into this conference, there was a gentleman's agreement, again, among all of the modern nations, all of the Western nations, all of the money nations, that our goal was going to be 2 degrees centigrade. But we have to realize there's no scientific basis for 2 degrees centigrade as being safe. There isn't. 2 degrees centigrade, we're at 1 degree centigrade increase right now. 2 degrees is going to wreck holy hell upon the earth. So the developing world, particularly the island nations, but those nations that border deserts, they mounted a campaign called 1.5 to stay alive, which is, let's make the action so we limit the rise to 1.5 degrees. So, the conference was shocked. At the opening day of the conference, the host nation was France. The president of France gets up and instead of saying 2 degrees, he says 1.5. Yeah. He violates the gentleman's agreement that all the rich nations had agreed it was going to be 2, and he comes out in favor of 1.5, and they're totally shocked. And so they met for 2 weeks, and as conferences go, they always go long, right? Nothing happens until there's a time pressure, and the time pressure compromise. But the word came out on the second Friday, when the conference was supposed to end, that they were so close they were going to go into second, right? But there was a problem. There was a problem. And the problem was the word shall. The problem was the word shall. The United States delegation was looking at the Republican Congress and said, we're never going to get this passed, the Republican Congress, if we keep the word shall. It has to be should, so that it's voluntary instead of required. The French, being the diplomats that they are, said, it's all our mistake, it was supposed to be should all along, we lost it in translation, and they changed the word. But the problem with shall, or should, shall says we will, we must. Should says we ought, we might. So we come out of this COP21 conference with an agreement that it requires voluntary participation. There's no force of law. There is no penalty other than name or shame if we don't meet the agreement. So, how do we move should to shall? Even though it's in the negotiation that it should, how do we move that our government actually takes the action to move should to shall? This is where people of ethics have a role to play. We have to pressure, we have to change the story, we have to make it real. We have to insist that if our children and our grandchildren are going to have a life, we have to stop global warming dead in its tracks right now. The actual results, political versus philosophical, governments had all agreed that it was time to drastically reduce global warming. So the good news out of the conference is the first time every single government, all 195 countries plus the European Union, 196 government bodies, agreed that global warming is real, it's happening now, it's caused by humans, and we have to take action. That's the good stuff. So it sends a strong, strong word and encouragement out to government planners and the businesses and the corporations and the investment things that we have to move away from fossil fuels. And if you've been following the news of the last 7 months, this is starting to happen. It's really, it's starting to happen. Even Saudi Arabia has announced a plan to get out of fossil fuels. Now they're 40 years out, they're 50 years out, but they've announced a plan that they recognize that the generation, the era of fossil fuels, the era of oil is coming. 180 countries representing 98% of global emissions officially put forward national climate plans. That's the good news. They were asked to commit what they're willing to do to reduce the amount of carbon that's going up in the atmosphere. 180 nations put forth what their plans are. That's the good news. Right? The agreement encourages countries to improve over time to have your formal reassessment every 5 years. Some countries tried to put it for every 20 years. It was very important that it be every 5 years, and it gets strengthened as a country. And then there was a target of $100 billion a year to go into the Global Green Fund. One of the things we've done is we've used up all of the fossil fuels and we put all of the carbon up in the atmosphere that the Earth can take. Yet there is still 1.4 billion people without electricity across the Earth. We can't have them go the cheap way like we did. We can't have them get their electricity from burning coal and oil and gas. And so we have a responsibility as the rich nations in the world to fund renewable energy projects in their towns, their cities. All right, what's the downside? I told you 180 countries agreed and put forth voluntary commitments to reduce. The goal is maximum 2 degrees centigrade with a target of as close to 1.5 as we can. But if you add up all of the reductions that the countries agreed to do, we're actually going to be at 3.5 degrees centigrade if we carry through on this. 3.5 degrees centigrade, right? 7 degrees Fahrenheit. Human civilization will cease to exist if we let it get up there. Human civilization will cease to exist. Why? Because we'll kill each other. We'll get so short of resources, we'll have so many hundreds of millions looking for a place to grow their families. We'll break out in war all over. We'll kill each other. So, COP 21. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. Now our efforts have to be focused on making it real. Making it should become a shall. Making the temperature limit not go above 2 degrees, and if at all possible, go to 1.5 degrees. You got to realize that we're right there at the boundary right now. So, in the recent news, on the first day it was possible to do so, 175 nations gathered in New York to sign the Paris Climate Accord on April 21st. That broke all records for how fast a United Nations Accord was signed. There's a picture of Secretary John Kerry holding his granddaughter signing it for the U.S. France, a week ago, became the second European country to ratify after Hungary, and the first of the group of seven modern nations to ratify the treaty. The Paris Agreement to keep the temperatures below 2 degrees centigrade comes into force with 55 nations having 55% of the pollution signed. So France is the first major nation to do. China has agreed that they're going to sign and ratify the treaty by the end of the year. So will we. There's other good news that's been going on. Scotland is now coal-free. Scotland is going to be 100% renewable by 2020, primarily with offshore wind. Sweden is going to go carbon neutral by 2045. Some other countries are saying they're going to be carbon neutral by 2030. In recent news, a couple of nations, Germany being one of them, and there's a Scandinavian one that's the second, are going to only allow electric cars to be purchased after 2030. Germany's drawing up plans to reduce its greenhouse gas emissions by 95% by 2050. I have a daughter-in-law from Bavaria, and a couple years ago we went over there for the wedding, and on every rooftop in Bavaria are solar panels.
Yeah.
Every rooftop. I've had people tell me, well, Germany can lead us in solar power because they get more sun than we do, because, you know, when it's nighttime here, it's sunlight over there. They actually get less sunlight than we do. So, this is an issue of justice. It's an issue that the people who are going to get hurt first and worst had nothing to do with causing this crisis.
Yeah.
The underdeveloped nations of the earth did not burn this carbon, and they're the ones that are paying the price now. We've mistakenly founded the economy of our modern society in the burning of fossil fuels, oil, coal, and gas, and recklessly dumping their waste products in the atmosphere, the very air that we breathe. This collective action is dreadfully harming the least of these across the globe right now. It's threatening the actual survival of human civilization in the time to come. It's as immoral of an act to found an economy on the burning of fossil fuels as it was when we founded our economy on the enslavement of human beings. Millions and millions of people are dying now. Hundreds of millions of people will in the future. It's time for this era to end. People grounded in the ethics of justice played a vital role in the ending of slavery. You ever picture yourself if you've been around in the 1830s, the 1840s? Would you have been brave enough to stand and speak up that slavery was no way to found an economy? Would we have been brave enough? Would we be brave enough now to stand up and say that burning fossil fuels that's killing is no way to found an economy today? Both voices in the public square were needed then. Both voices in the public square are needed now. What can you do? Al, can you pass these off, Mike?
Sure.
I get to this point, and normally when I do presentations, I get much more into the effects of what's going on, and people get into the really despair, you know, that it's so bad that there's nothing that we can possibly do, so I want to go home, go back into bed, pull the blanket up over my head, and forget about this problem, or drown it in a good glass of scotch or whatever we might drink. And so I came up with action items that you could do in your own life. Right? There are three columns. The left-hand column are the easy ones. I call them toe dipping. So if you want to just stick your toe in sustainable living a little bit. The middle column is called wading in deeper. And the third column is called immerse as a way of life. You're going to look at this list of items and you're going to say, you know, some of these are so simple, they're so easy, I don't know why you even bother to write them down. And you're going to look at some of the other ones and you're going to say, you know what? You're nuts if you think I'm going to do that. You're absolutely nuts. But somewhere in between, if you go through these and you mark where you're at right now, you're going to find ones that you can consider doing in your own life. You're going to find ones that you, with a little bit of a stretch, you could accomplish this. And that's my challenge to you, is you take that home and you choose two or three or four and start working on it. Ultimately, this requires a political answer. It requires the banning of fossil fuels. And so ultimately, we're going to have to do this at the ballot box in one way, shape, or form. And you'll find that on the last sheet on the backside.
Yeah.
So dipping our toes, wading deeper, fully immersed. Rebecca Sonnet. If you ever get a chance to read Rebecca Sonnet, do it. She's a powerful word manager. And she says, sometimes an extraordinary or huge question comes along, and we try to marry it off to a mediocre answer. In the days and weeks and months to come, you're going to have people tell you, all that's needed is we get a little more mileage in our cars. All that's needed is that we put a little bit of a tax on fossil fuels. All that's needed is that we seed the clouds to make more clouds to sheet out the sun. That's not sufficient. What's necessary is that we end the era of fossil fuels. Wendell Berry. Anybody know Wendell Berry?
Sure.
Yeah.
Farmer, philosopher, poet. He says, it's all a question of story. We're in trouble right now because we do not have a good story. We're in between stories. The old story, the account of how we fit into it, is no longer effective yet. We have not yet learned the new story. We're still clinging to those three stories. The earth is too big, we can't hurt it. There's always more, so we don't have to worry what we consume. At the supremacy of the individual.
Number nine.
Yeah.
There's a Native American storyteller that always ends his stories this way. He says, so that's the new story, it's yours. Do with it what you will. Tell it to friends, turn it into a television movie, put it on a t-shirt, or just forget it. But don't say in the years to come that you would have lived your life differently if only you'd heard the story. Because you've heard it now. We can't keep pretending that we don't know that we're destroying the earth. For those of us with gray hair, there's a temptation to say, well, the kids, the younger generation, are going to have to handle it. There's a nun by the name of Sister Joan Chittister, who's a Benedictine abbess. And she writes on the wisdom of this age, for those of us with gray hair. And she says, age does not forgive us our responsibility to give the world back to God a bit better than it was because we were here. A blessing of this years is to have the opportunity to take on the role of the thinker, of philosopher, of disputant, of interrogator, of spiritual guide in a world racing to nowhere with no true human goal and no lived wisdom in sight. Our role now is to be what we've discovered about life. Our responsibility is wisdom. That's our role, to pass on the wisdom of our life experiences so that our kids and our grandkids don't repeat previous errors that we've done. So, what story will you tell your children to follow? What story will frame the rest of your life? If you're like me, and you somehow manage to pass on to your kids those three stories, maybe the first thing you need to do is to tell them that you're sorry, that you were wrong, that we have harmed the earth, that there are limits. We can't consume all life on this earth and think the future generations are going to live. And that ultimately, we all need each other, not the individual, but the community. This picture should have changed our story back in 1969. It didn't then. Maybe it can now. It's a fragile earth that we have. A fragile earth that right now has 7.4 billion people on it. 7.4 billion people on its way to 12 or 15 billion. Right now we're consuming at a level that would require 1.5 Earths to sustain. The problem is we only have one. And if everybody consumed at the level that we consume at, we would need 4 Earths. So we've got to find a different way to live. A way that we live in synergy and interdependence with each other and with everything else that's alive on this earth. Time to change our story. Thanks for giving me the opportunity to be with you.
All right, we'll get into the question and answer session now. Just give me a
stay up there.
Hang on, this is
you're gonna take questions.
Oh heck, where's my stuff here? Just give me a moment here.
Okay.
Alright. Alright, now the way it works, Dr. Gallagher, is that people raise their hands and I'll call on people, but you're the one who answers the questions.
Okay.
So but I'll all right, so who has a question? Everybody who has a question, raise your hand. By the way, I just want to reiterate that this is a time for questions, not for speeches. Okay, Tim, go ahead.
All right, I've seen your list of the activists in here. What do you think is going to be the most effective way to get us off of oil and onto a cleaner planet?
It's not going to be one way. It's going to be many ways. A lot of times we try to reduce things to either or. This is a both and situation. So we're at the cusp right now of where the technology for renewable energy is expanding exponentially. It's really a good time. It really is. I have a son who is a PhD at Argonne Labs working on the advanced batteries, the storage batteries for energy. And every time I see him, I tell him, you gotta work faster, we need those sooner, right? So the one thing is to keep growing this technology. So, and as it rolls out, the cost become less. Everybody was stunned a couple months ago when Tesla rolled out their new car, which isn't even being manufactured yet, and they got 400,000 orders that first 10 days. 400,000 orders. There's a hunger to go to renewable energy. And we've got the technology to do it. We got to keep rolling out. But the second thing, to answer your question, is we've got to quit subsidizing fossil fuels. Right now, we're still subsidizing the digging of the coal and the drilling of the oil and of the gas. We've got to come face to face and not only quit subsidizing, but we have to actually ban their use. They're causing harm.
Dennis, did you have a question?
Yeah, great presentation. Of course, Donald Trump is the presumed presidential candidate for the Republican Party. He's come out and said that the agreement achieved in Paris is inadequate, and he'd go back and renegotiate the entire thing. What do you think about that?
Yeah. I'm going to do this very above board. Donald Trump advocates two radically different responses to the climate change crisis. The first response is the one you cited, that it's a bunch of hooey, and it's a plot to have China take over the world, right? And it's not real. It's not real. The second response, which is under the visibility of politics, is he's protecting his assets against the rising seas.
Yes.
So he's got a golf course in Scotland, and he's trying to build a big retention wall to keep the seas out because it's where heating is coming up. So he's talking out of both sides, which is not unusual for the Donald at all. But you're not going to do it. You're not going to go back and negotiate this. What you're going to have to do is find a way to make it stronger. You need to move the words should back to shall. Right. Good question.
Thank you. All right. Does anybody else have a question? Okay, Gene, go ahead.
Yeah, probably a couple people in the room have read this book, This Changes Everything, by Naomi Klein.
Yep.
What do you know that book, and what do you think of it?
I know that book. Naomi does a great job of detailing the expansiveness of this problem, you know, how it's intertwined in our whole economy and what our economy is based on. Where Naomi falls short of is only in what's going to be necessary to change it. And so that really takes a whole second volume. And she's very active in this work. I'm a great admirer of Naomi, but I think she was hesitant to talk about the radical restructuring of how we organize our economy in order to move from fossil fuels to a sustainable life. And that's what's going to be necessary.
Thank you. If I may ask a follow-up to Gene's question, are you saying that, and I haven't read the book, but what you're saying about this book is that she describes the problem, but she doesn't come up with very many solutions? Is that what you're saying?
Watch her movie.
Well, let the speaker talk, please.
Yeah, I agree. Naomi does a really great job of exposing those stories that I was talking about and the depth and the breadth of the problem. And she kind of guides the opening dawn of where you're going to start looking for the answer. She doesn't have do this.
Okay.
Because that's something we still have to solve for ourselves.
Okay. All right, Serge, do you have a question?
Yeah. What do we have to take carbon out of the atmosphere?
Well, I can tell you, as a chemical plant manager, taking parts per million out is a lot harder than not putting the parts per million in.
Yeah.
Right? The first thing is the idea that we're going to vacuum the carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere is a pipe dream. It's whistling in the face of a storm. It's perpetuated by the fossil fuel companies that want to have a license to keep on burning their assets.
Yeah.
It comes out of the problem is we recognize that only 20% of the identified fossil fuels can be burned or we destroy the earth. Yeah. That means the other 80% have to stay right where they're
ground.
Okay? That causes a $20 trillion, with a T, $1 trillion, write-off of the assets that are claimed by the oil and the coal and the gas companies. So they're going to do everything they can possibly think of to delay the day we say, enough, you can't do it. Because that's money. That's real. $20 trillion, that's real money. Now, there is concern that we've gone too far already.
Right?
And so there are very smart people who are showing their stupidity playing around with geoengineering. Right? One of the things that we have from an ethics standpoint is before we affect the earth and all the life systems, we really ought to think very long and hard about it. We ought to try and understand what are the unintended consequences of the actions that we take. And so one of the things, the idea is being, is we're going to put a fleet of jets up in the upper atmosphere, and they're going to seed the upper atmosphere with sulfite, right? And so it's going to reflect the sun back out into space, kind of like a volcano does. The very, very powerful volcanoes shoot up their ash in the upper atmosphere, and for a couple weeks, the temperature goal does drop a little bit because it screens up sun. But it filters out, it comes down with the rain, and eventually comes up. So you have to have a constant fleet of this aircraft going around the globe, spreading these sulfites in the upper atmosphere. Now, to think that we know what all is going to happen to the earth when we just pollute that much, that's silly. There's some other ideas on how to do it. One of them is that you can go to what they call closed capture. And so at the end of smokestacks, you can take a pipe and bring the pollution down into the deep stone structure and turn it into stone. Nobody has yet proved that they can do this, one, economically, and two, forever. Right? And so the idea is we have another short-term answer. We inject a bunch of old wells with carbon dioxide, and like everything else, it'll bubble back up to the surface and move back in the runaway reaction. There is another idea that's being formulated, which is you can take not fossil fuels, but you can take current living things and burn them. So trees right now take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere and replace it with oxygen. You could take trees, and if you burn them and captured that and inject it down and turn it into stone, you are effectively taking carbon dioxide. I think that's a pipe dream too, but it's something that... And they're looking at all these things because we've done so much damage, and we're on such an exponential curve to do more damage. How can we help put the brakes on? Another thing they're looking at is seeding the oceans with iron to counteract the fact that the oceans absorb carbon dioxide and turn into the oceans acidic because the oceans make it into carbonic acid, and that's killing off the shell creatures and the coral reefs and also the basic bottom of the food chain. That again is got rife with unintended consequences of what's going to happen. So the short answer is we don't know. The only ethical answer is quit putting the stuff up there, right, and do it now. The strongest thing that we're missing is a sense of urgency. Remember I told you the science is over 100 years old? Over 80 years ago, the concern was so much by the scientific community, established a lab to measure it every day. 50 years ago, the first president mentioned it. 35 years ago, the first Congress was told it was happening. We're measuring it now. We're still lacking the sense of urgency that we have to act. Let me put it very harsh. I'm not long for this earth. I'm in the last portion of my life. But if my grandkids are going to have a chance, we have to solve this while I'm still breathing. Because we're unleashing it.
All right. Charlie, did you have a wait, Mike had his hand up first. Mike, did you have a question?
Yeah, I have a two-part question. Are you from Chicago?
I'm from Cleveland, and then Detroit, and for the last 3 years, Aurora.
Aurora, okay. You've been to these COP conferences, right? How many have you been to?
Just the one.
How many people go? Like 20, 30, 50,000 people?
Probably 10,000.
10,000 or more?
Well, yeah, you're probably right with 20.
It's usually somewhere around the globe.
Yeah, it's in a major location around the globe.
So isn't it kind of hypocritical for 10 or 20,000 people to burn 10,000, or laws of thermodynamics, it's 50 gallons per 1,000 miles. So if somebody went 10,000 miles, it would be 500 gallons of jet fuel. Isn't it pretty hypocritical for these 20,000 people to fly to Paris or Rio and burn 500 gallons of gas, jet fuel, and the resultant climate change gases, and then come up with no solution. Just say we should change a word from should to shall. I think that's a real poor use of resources and huge pollution.
We need to kind of move things along, Mike.
Well, listen, I'm sick of hearing climate change people acting.
How holy are the thou?
And it's a question. Is it hypocritical?
Mike, save it for the rebuttal period, okay? Now,
is it hypocritical?
Mike, be quiet. Let the speaker talk.
Yeah. I think it's hypocritical.
Mike, you're out of order. Let the speaker talk. Okay, go ahead.
No, they shouldn't have a local.
No, they took the
fucking guys, book. One fool at a time, okay? Let the fool who has the mic every 5 years. Hey, Mike. Mike, one fool at a time, okay? Stop being angry. Let the speaker talk.
I want an answer.
Well, if you would shut up, maybe the speaker could answer. Whoa, now let Mike talk. I'm let the speaker talk.
You're not, Mike, you're not the first one that raised that question.
I hope so.
All right. But it's a greater hypocrisy. If we don't take it, it's a greater hypocrisy if we say that if we bring the nations of the earth together, they're going to increase the problem momentarily, and we shouldn't do anything, so we shouldn't take action. The fact of the matter is, pulling together all the nations of the earth is a long, involved process, and it takes coming together to make the actions. It takes having the discipline to push and to push and to push on governments who are funded by a fossil fuel company to take action. And so this last one, you can argue about the previous 19, but you can't argue about this last one. This last one accomplished it.
What's the solution?
What's the solution?
It came out with in Paris.
The solution is that every government is going to agree and to take actions to reduce the amount of carbon that we're putting on the earth. Every government of the nations, even Saudi Arabia and Russia, have agreed.
Yeah,
okay.
All right. Charlie, do you have a question?
Nothing to say.
Yeah, you get here tonight. You only came here by bike.
Bike?
Yeah.
Damn okay. Straight.
Yeah, you're on the
wait, wait.
Bike.
Guys,
right.
Out of time. Let Charlie talk.
Yeah, let's hear it. Terry, on the back of your thing, you talk about something called gospel justice. Can you define that for us? And the other thing is, regarding gospel justice, I happened to look at it just yesterday, and there's nothing in scriptures that forbids global warming.
Ah, yes.
And I don't recollect it being in the Ten Commandments, nor do I recollect having waited 2 hours to ask my question, that I don't recollect ever in studying theology, even the Unitarians, I don't think, got into ecological issues.
You're wrong.
Until recently, perhaps.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely wrong. Let me back you up a little bit.
I mean, where's...
And I didn't want to get into theology because
right,
you have a second, but I'll just point out one thing. Every major religion of the world, has some form of the golden rule. Every major world religion has some form of the golden rule, which says, I shall do unto others as I would want to be treated myself. And so it applies to ecology. It applies that we're going to let future generations live because we would want to live if future past generations had treated us well. There is deep theology, but we don't have the time. But sometimes maybe you could have me back if we could do it, right?
I thought that related to interpersonal interaction.
The golden rule.
Doesn't that pertain to interpersonal, like, relations?
That's one dimension of it. In a global community, it refers to how we coexist with each other. To say it doesn't is to shortchange the ability of human civilizations to live together. That's a shame. That's a shame.
All right. Lee Ping, did you have a question?
Yeah, I heard some people or vegetarians, they said the meat industry is a big producer of methane gas, which is very bad, even worse than the carbon dioxide. And we should do something about that.
That's true. Methane gas is 85, 86 times more powerful of a greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide over 20 years. It's 20 times more powerful over 100 years. Methane gas is absolutely something that we have to deal with. That's why fracking and fracking leaks are terrible. But also the animal factory farms are terrible. So you see a couple action items on there to reduce the amount of meat you have. Vegans would argue that it is the vast majority of the problem. That's not really true. It's about, depending on who you go to, 20% to 30% of the problem. So it's a big chunk. It really is a big chunk. Right? But the problem isn't that easy. Yeah? It takes a lot more than that. It takes bringing us into every element of our life, of our economy, to get away from millions of smokestacks and billions of exhaust pipes, but also to reduce the factory farms and the waste that they're, you know, they have these huge pig farms in Iowa and Idaho. 1.5 million pigs, 2 million pigs, and their waste are just put into a pond where they vaporize all of that methane to the atmosphere with no penalty for doing that. So we've got to get wise about a whole bunch of things we do in this order. We really do. That's a good point.
Okay. All right. Is there anybody else who has a question who has not? Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Could you speak up, please, sir?
You gave a presentation once of all the trinkets that we produce. I mean, we are producing millions and millions of new trinkets every time we have to have a newer and newer.
Yeah.
All that garbage produces garbage.
Yeah.
Is there going to be an end to it? And then my second question is, when are we going to have more consideration for the other citizens of this world besides us?
That's two good questions. One is directly tied to the idea that there's always more, and so we got to have the latest trinket, the latest technology, the latest widget. And that's fed by our marketing system. And our marketing system really came of age in the Great Depression. It was created to get America buying again, and they got too good at what they do. Okay? And so they founded our economy on always more. And creating that hunger in us to always have more. You ever go to a store and pick something up, and after you're leaving the store, or maybe while you're still in the store, you wonder, why did I pick up that one item? What drove me that I thought I had to have that item? There's a lot of subliminal messages, a huge marketing psychology that goes on to drive that hunger in us to have more. And it's not just limited to us more. I've gone on immersion experiences around the globe, in Palestine, in Mexico, and in Colombia, and even in places that don't have electricity, they'll fire up a generator and they'll aim the one dish that they have in the whole village, and the village will come around and watch a program, and they'll get exposed to our commercials so that they want these trinkets too. Right? And so that's why we consume at a level that requires four Earths. If we get the rest of the $7.4 billion on it, we're hosed. We're hosed. We got to break this. We got to break this addiction.
All right. David?
Yes. Is any of the Pope's criticisms of the way we're treating the environment and also of commercialism and commercial lifestyle?
Yes.
Is any of that having any effect?
Okay. The question, if I can repeat it, is has any of the very strong criticism that the Pope Francis has made, both on our treatment of ecology and our treatment of other human beings and capitalism, has it had any effect? And the answer is yeah, it is having an effect. I'm seeing more of this being raised. I've gone to interfaith conferences with all of the faiths, gathered around just discerning how we can take the Pope's message into our different faith communities. I sometimes think that the College of the Cardinals that chose Francis, right, are sitting in the back room right now saying, what did we do? What did we do? And he wasn't supposed to be like that. He was just going to be this nice guy from Argentina. I mean, what did we do? Yeah, he's a really neat guy. Now, he's got much more different personal moral restrictions than I have, but from an ecological base, an economic base, and an economy base, he's the right guy.
All right, I wanted to ask a follow-up question to what the gentleman back there was asking about, because he was talking about this buying trinkets was the term you used, and I noticed here on your sheet. Right here on the first row, mm-hmm. you have well, it has apparently it has to do with buying things and reestablish here. It says right, reestablish the ancient practice of Sabbath keeping in your family's life. Keep it simple but meaningful by avoiding purchasing anything on one specific day each week. And then if you want to get in deeper, change your personal economics to support local-based business such as community cooperatives, community businesses, credit unions, etc. What I wanted to ask you is, what does that have to do with global warming?
It's the consumption of all of that, and the forces that we invest all of that money into, which are fighting against stopping fossil fuels.
Oh, you're saying that manufacturing these products, it adds to the emissions that would lead to global warming.
Well, driving the hunger of our consumption. Consuming the Earth's resources in most of the ways drives that.
Oh.
Okay. Sabbath. Right? Anybody know the term Sabbath? What does it mean? It
means a rest or a day.
A day of rest, right? It's usually in our society convened as on Sunday, those who go to church will go to church. That's the Sabbath. What we lost was the ancient concept that Sabbath is much more than it's a time to spend in contemplation. Sabbath is meant to break the economic control of our lives with money. Right? So if you go into ancient scripture on Sabbath, Sabbath keeping, not only could you not work, but you couldn't let your slaves work. You couldn't let your beasts of burden work. Right? Every week. On the seventh year, he had to forgive debts. On the Sabbath of the Sabbath, on the 49th year, going into the 50th year, the year of the Jubilee, everybody had to be restored to be an equal. Now, we've lost all of those ideas. My own guess is that come year 49, somebody came up with the idea, we were really just talking spiritual things, we didn't really mean economy. So we made up rules to avoid dealing with the economy. But that's why I call it, is to consciously break this habit that I can buy whatever I want, whenever I want it, all the time. To make us pause in that, to think about what do we need? What do we really need in order to live?
Okay. Carl, you had your hand up. Did you have a question?
Yeah, earlier you had mentioned Mr. Trump. So where do like the other candidates like Hillary and Bernie and maybe even the Green Party, how do they stand and where would you rate them, you know, as far as you know, good stewards to the environment?
Nowhere near enough. Unfortunately, Hillary has supported expanded fossil fuel explorations in the past. So I have grave concern with, can we get her to actually embrace the ending of the fossil fuel era. Right? Bernie has spoken more on this, but it's a late blooming for Bernie. So I don't know how rooted his beliefs are in this. And I'm hoping that he does. And I'm hoping that we're starting to see a movement of ending this. But there are as many fossil fuel interests funding the Democratic Party as there are funding the Republican Party.
All right. Charlie, Dennis had his hand up first. Dennis, go ahead.
In your reading list, you mentioned Storms of Our Grandchildren by Dr. James Hansen. He's a prominent climate scientist who's been discussed here at the college before. Well, Dr. Hansen was at the Paris conference with three other climatologists, and they were supporting a new generation of nuclear reactors to, quote unquote, solve our climate crisis. Are we missing something, or is nuclear power nothing but a big loser?
Boy, if that ain't a loaded question, I don't know what it is. All right. Hansen started out studying the planet Venus. And he noticed that Venus was so much hotter than Earth, but it was also so much hotter than Mercury. And Mercury's closer to the Sun, so why? And the reason is Venus has a very thick carbon dioxide-based atmosphere. And he connected that to what was happening on Earth, so he changed to being a climate scientist. And he looks upon the burning of fossil fuels, and he says, right now, that's killing millions of people. Right now, it's killing millions of people. And we still need to expand our energy, and so he holds up nuclear as a viable answer to it. And he specifically holds up the fourth generation nuclear. Yep. We're on one and a half generation right now. Right? And so he's become a strong advocate of it because he says, nobody's been killed by nuclear, I would disagree with him, but certainly not the millions that have been killed by fossil fuels. So he's right in that point. All right, my answer to nuclear is, number one, the current technology is unethical. It is absolutely unethical to create a waste stream that lasts as a hazardous substance for tens of thousands of years. There is no ethics that says that we can pass our problems like that on to future generations just for the convenience of turning on a light. There's no ethics to that. And so current nuclear doesn't have. Does future nuclear have? Maybe. We'll have to see how the research comes. But it's not going to be here in time. Okay? So the only way to stop global warming right now is with renewable energy. And we need to roll it out on the same basis that we answered the call to arms in World War II, when we changed airplane car plants into making airplanes and machine guns. We've got to do that with renewable energy. We've got to do it at that level.
Yes.
Maybe nuclear energy has a place to play when we move from 12 billion to 15 billion if we keep on growing. And they have the fourth generation mini nuclear plants that don't have the waste that we have. That's 40, 50, 60 years out. The other thing, on a very practical standpoint, is nuclear has priced itself out of the market right now. There's no way.
Yeah.
I mean, they built a solar, there's a couple ways to get energy from the sun, right? One is photovoltaic, right? The other one is concentrated solar plants. So you use mirrors to intensify the light to a tower that's holding salt. You melt the salt, and it becomes the heat media that boils the water and drives the turbines. The advantage of doing that is the salt keeps making power after the sun goes down, right? Yeah. Concentrated solar power. They just built one, and they took the bids on it in Abu Dhabi, right? So the center of oil, right? They built a concentrated solar power plant there that's going to sell electricity for 3 cents, right? It's cheaper than oil. Right? What we're seeing is this explosion in renewable energy technologies, which are going to make fossil fuels eventually extinct. We just got to make it happen faster.
Okay. Well, Charlie, did you have a question?
Let's add two, but I'll leave it at one. In row one in the middle, you say change your personal economics. Are you advocating socialism or communism? Or do you think free market capitalism is polluting? Is that what you're talking to about there?
What I'm talking about is that
it's all right.
Our current form of capitalism is what I call vulture capitalism. It's capitalism unrestrained. It's capitalism that is allowed to take the meat and the muscle and the sinew and the blood off of what they scavenge out of the globe. Right? Capitalism run amok without restrictions is destroying Europe. It doesn't mean you have to go to socialism. You can go to a structured capitalism that has limits on what corporations can do. But that's a tough call. But yeah. We have to get to a sustainable economics based on I'm willing to forego some of my wants, some of my desires, so that you have what's necessary to live. That's the economic system we have.
All right.
Okay. All right. Does anybody else have a question at this time? Well, Charlie, before I get to your question, I wanted to ask you a question, which I know is a dumb one before I even say it, but what year was COP21?
Last December.
Oh, okay.
2015.
12. Okay, December 2015. Okay, I should remember. Okay, Charlie, go ahead.
Yeah, following up on Mike's question here.
Is this the second question that you said you were going to have?
Yes.
All right.
How many times have you given this lecture? And according to Mike, shouldn't the people have stayed at home because they use energy to go to the meeting?
What you can do, if you have an ethical basis, you can do what I did, is that you pay for trees to be planted that consume the carbon dioxide that was emitted in order to get you to that place.
I mean, I'm not accused of creating global warming by giving lectures, according to him.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's not the first time I've heard that.
Yeah, this is going to be the last.
I've also had people, want to argue the physical laws of the universe with me. And I tell them I don't argue the physical laws of the universe. They don't need my permission to exist. They simply exist.
You know? Yeah, right.
If I was to argue about the physical law of the universe, I would argue against the law of gravity. Because I don't like gravity. As I've gotten older, it's made me shorter. It makes my joints ache. Right? And so if I could argue against the physical law of the universe, it wouldn't be the fact that if I increase the carbon dioxide content in the atmosphere, I'm going to heat up the Earth. I would argue against gravity. I don't like gravity. But here's the thing. I know if I step off my third floor balcony of my condo in Aurora, I will encounter the reality of gravity as soon as I go splat, right? And it's the truth with the physics of the atmosphere. We are going to encounter that with the same physical response as that splat on the sidewalk. We don't change.
All right. Does anybody else have a question at this time? No? All right. Well, if I may, I would like to ask you one more question, Doctor. This is going to make me sound anti-American. Doesn't most of the opposition to stopping global warming come from the Republicans and the U.S. government? And I wonder if you could talk about why that may, or why that, if that is the case, and why.
It's not true. All of the opposition to accepting that global warming is happening and humans are causing comes from English-speaking people. All opposition comes from English-speaking people, and it comes from those who have vested interests in making money on it. And so there's the Republican Party in the U.S., there's the strict conservatives in England, and there's the Yahoos in Australia, all right? So who are making their money exporting coal to the Far East, right? And the real answer is, who is opposing taking action on global warming can be answered by who is profiting from burning the fossil fuel.
So what you're saying is that the opposition is coming from the fossil fuel industry.
Absolutely.
And then in the countries where they're strong, they get a political party in these countries to kind of act as their spokesman. They give them money to act as spokesman on their behalf if the country is democratic. That's what you're saying. Okay, fair enough. But wait a second. Look, this is a little bit of a follow-up. But isn't one of the biggest oil corporations headquartered in the Netherlands? Shell Oil? What's the Netherlands say about all this global warming stuff?
That's Dutch,
okay.
It's a tale. Remember the tale of two countries, the tale of two cities. Holland is the tale of two countries.
Okay.
So Holland makes a great deal of money off of furnishing the world with fossil fuels. Mm-hmm. At the same time, they accept global warming and they're going 100% renewable themselves. They haven't yet stopped profiting. So there's a basic ethical question here of your economics. If it is wrong to destroy the earth, it is equally wrong to profit from its destruction. Right? And so Dutch Shell has that same problem. And they did a major, colossal misjudgment pushing to drill in the Arctic. And there was very effective campaigns that were waged to illustrate what would happen if they were successful at it. And there were barricades that were done in the ports to try and block the great oil platforms that were going up. And they really screwed up their drilling platforms, and they've called off the adventure after wasting $2 billion on it, right? And they've now agreed they're not going to do it. And so we're all focused on Dutch Shell, right, for a while. But Russia is doing it. The Arctic right now is being claimed by 7 different countries. Right? Why? Well, because the Arctic is melting. Why? Well, because we're heating up the Earth. The Arctic is melting. But since the Arctic is melting, we can now get at those oil and gas resources that are deep under that frozen ice that we couldn't get at before, which we can't get at because if we keep getting at it, we're going to heat up the Earth, which is going to destroy it more. But for the moment, we could make some money. Anybody ever see that cartoon where it's an adult sitting around a campfire with a group of kids, and he's holding a philosophical discussion? He says, it's true that our actions destroyed the earth, but for a moment in time, we returned to our stockholders a very enviable rate of return.
Okay.
Before the end of the earth.
All right, now listen. All right, sir, did you have a question?
Question, drilling for oil in the ocean.
Yeah.
we take it out, what do we replace with seawater? What do? We replace that vacuum in there with water or what?
Usually.
We take that oil out.
Usually.
Yeah, it has to, because otherwise you'd have a vacuum down there, you'd have a...
Let the speaker talk, please.
You have to put in a concrete plug to seal it off. And so what you typically do is you will drill two wells, okay? And so in one well, you pressure down and you extract up out of the other one, okay? So you shoot stuff down into the stone layer that has the fossil fuel, push it over to the other well, and then it comes up because it's being pressured down. And so now this hole that I've got here that's got oil coming out, when we stop it, we have to seal that off because you still got the pressure coming on the other one. And so you put in a concrete cap. That's what led to the major disaster in the Gulf. They cheated on that concrete cap. They were under pressure to go drill the next well. They were 2 weeks behind schedule. And as a plant manager, I can tell you there's a thing called time pressure compromise. If I am short of time, there's always so much pressure to get the job done and move on, right? And so somebody had the bright idea we could shorten the time it takes to cure this concrete by changing the additives. And they did that, and it blew up.
Now you're adding more, right?
That's not what I heard.
Okay.
Market capital.
All right, Tim, did you have a question?
I did, but this is a very brief one. Just give us a little bit more about what your background is and what you do for a living.
So, I started out as an engineer in the chemical industry. I spent 32 years in the chemical industry, eventually as a plant manager of not one, but two chemical plants as a bit of a workaholic. Highly hazardous chemical plants running in Wyandotte, Michigan, just outside of Detroit. When I took an early retirement, when I turned 55, and I took the road to ministry. I was a local pastor of two churches in Detroit for half a dozen years when I felt the calling by world experiences I had to go into a ministry of ecological justice. And so for the last 4 years, this is my ministry. I go wherever anybody will sit long enough to hear me speak to try and raise our awareness of this. Nobody pays me for this. They couldn't pay me enough.
You have a chemical engineer degree?
Oddly enough, I've got a mechanical engineer degree, but I manage chemical plants.
All right, now that, I'm afraid we are out of time for questions, so we're going to have to go right into the rebuttals. Before we do, let's have a round of applause for our speaker. Let's give it up for Dr. Gallagher. All right, now let's get into the rebuttals. Oh, sir, you...
Pollution is the worst of the devil.
Okay.
So you have a couple.
Four. Okay. Central. All right. All right. Now, first of all, let's just... I have a seat now. We'll get into the rebuttals right away. Now, first of all, how many people want to speak? Everybody that wants to give a rebuttal speech, raise your hand. I'm going to count hands. Okay. One, two, three. Keep them hands up, y'all. Four, five, six, seven, and eight. And I'm going to say nine, and then of course we have the speaker, but you'll speak at 8:40 p.m. So, all right, Tim, I guess
4 minutes.
4 minutes each. Okay,
right, I got a timer.
All right, 4 minutes. Okay, Mike, you're on deck.
Thank
go
you,
ahead.
Thank you.
All right.
I'm going to put chairs up.
Oh boy, Mike.
For next year. I'm glad you're here.
This way, Mike.
In this ecological field, I work on some degrees in environment issues and transportation issues. So you must, I'd like to hear what your other degrees are, that'd be good. Anyway, look gang, the problem is oil. Okay, we go to wars for oil, we go to wars with oil, they're fought with oil, they're not fought with coal, they're not fought with natural gas. And these climate change people in Al Gore are getting me a little fed up because they have these meetings every 5 years all over the world. They burn tons of jet fuel. They come up with no solutions. They just bitch. And frankly, I'm getting tired of climate change. And plus, not only that, they make it a one-issue subject. And it's not a one-issue subject. They should be saying climate change and air pollution. Now, nobody gives a rat's ass about air pollution or noise pollution. We got half of the city of Chicago is complaining about O'Hare Airport because of air pollution, noise pollution, carcinogens. And these people take, Al Gore takes our eye off the ball and puts all his marbles into climate change. And it's a, you know what, it could be, it can't be. Climate change is not a right now issue. Climate change is something that might happen in 10 years, 50 years, 100 years, 200 years. And so it gives oil companies, the military, all these people, all kinds of time to deny it, obfuscate, excuse themselves, delay. And I really don't like these climate change 10,000 people flying around the world burning all this jet fuel. So the problem isn't coal. We're replacing coal quite a bit, as you saw, with windmills, solar, hydro, nuclear, there's all kinds of things. We're not running out of, we don't fight wars for coal. We don't fight wars for natural gas. We go to war for oil, period. And oil, when you talk about oil, oil is transportation. Transportation is oil. 75% of oil goes to transportation, primarily airplanes and cars. Trucks and rail and construction use of oil are much more efficient. But the use of aviation and super automotive use is something that's discretionary. So of course the climate change people give us no solutions, but we get to hear about their trip every 5 years. That's about all I got to say, but I do have a solution. You've all heard of the New York-Chicago bullet train. It's sustainable. It would save 5 billion gallons of oil a year from being burnt. So there's a solution. Maybe electric cars some days will be a solution. I would like to present you, sir. My email is on the back. You can learn a lot about sustainability and oil and transportation. Again, oil is the problem, not coal, not natural gas. And hopefully the climate change people will figure something out, because I'm getting tired of hearing from them.
All right, thank you very much, Mike.
What's up, boy, Mike?
Okay, you're on. Okay.
Damn, climate change.
So watch that.
Oh, I can't see it.
Oh, I can see it. Okay. Yeah, well, of course, I'm a UU, Unitarian. Our seventh principle is responsible search for truth and meaning. That's our fourth, excuse me. Respect for the interdependent web of all existence of which we are a part. Any UU worth his pledge will be an environmentalist like me. And I don't feel lonely. As far as the speaker had to say, well, I had a teacher and taught drafting, Mr. Schmiegel, and one of his favorite lines was, "Tell me something I don't know, buddy. Your talk was excellent. I've heard at least 80% of it before, right here. Nothing strange there." Talk about stories. Well, the three stories I liked are three big lies. My wife doesn't understand me. Hell, his wife knows just what he's about. The second one, it's in the mail, another big lie. The third one, the market will take care of it. We've heard that here all the time. Hey, the market ain't gonna take care of it. Collapse by Jared Diamond. Where did I hear about that? Right here. I went with other people from college and complexes and saw Jared Diamond. This has happened again and again and again and again and again in history. Read that book, you'll know about it. And of course, we've heard about this one too. Clouds of doubt. Andy Anderson has told us again and again, there are these guys who make a lot of money by bringing doubt about this, and they've done a great job. Get that DVD, you'll see that. And the final one, I put stuff on the information desk there. Let's see, where am I at? Two. Okay, about why America failed. All you gotta do is a clean, close reading of that book and you'll figure it out. We're probably doomed. Don't worry, I'm 78 years old. I figure by the figuring out how long you live, I'll be gone by 85. I don't have any kids, I don't have any grandkids. I know I don't. So I hope you guys fix this up. Join me, we'll do it.
All right.
When you're ready, Dennis.
Well, my name is Dennis Nelson. Well, it's too bad that I couldn't join you folks in Paris. However, I did my part as a climate justice activist here on the home front. These action alerts were done for this year's Earth Day. On Friday, April 15th, from the World Wildlife Fund to the U.S. House and the U.S. Senate, tell Congress to support the Paris Climate Agreement. On Wednesday, April 20th, from the Natural Resources Defense Council, ask the Big Five Nations to deliver their Paris climate commitments. On Friday, April 22nd, Earth Day proper, from the Sierra Club, adding my support for the Paris Climate Agreement as a citizen signer. On Saturday, April 23rd, Earth Day weekend, from the Climate Reality Project, to world leaders, thank you for signing the Paris Agreement. In other earlier action alerts, I recommended these six goals for the International Climate Agreement: keeping the Earth's average surface temperature increased between 1.5 degrees and 2 degrees Celsius, including a climate justice human rights provision, providing at least $100 billion annually by the richer nations to the poorer nations by 2020 to help with lower carbon energy sources and climate adaptation, keeping two-thirds of the Earth's fossil fuel reserves in the ground permanently, achieving a technically and economically feasible worldwide 100% renewable energy economy by 2050, putting a price on carbon. Oh, by the way, nuclear power was a big loser at the Paris Climate Summit. I'm a longtime member of the Chicago-based Nuclear Energy Information Service, NEIS, Illinois Nuclear Power Watchdog Group. All energy sources should follow the 2x4 rule of mitigating human-made climate disruption. The two major constraints are time and money. The four rules of operation are: an energy choice must remove the most amount of carbon in the quickest time at the lowest cost possible without creating, substituting, or worsening equally environmentally damaging, socially unjust, or unacceptable alternatives like proliferation, terrorism, war, waste, etc. Nuclear power fails all these conditions because it's such a big loser. I'm not going to mince any words. This is according to the Energy Transitions Commission, which has global leaders from energy companies, the investment sector, public and academic institutions, and foundations. The world needs a drastic change to reduce the carbon emissions from our energy supply and substantially increase our energy productivity, the economic output generated from each unit of energy used. This is to reach the goal of limiting the Earth's average surface temperature to well below 2 degrees Celsius that the delegates at the Climate Summit committed to. In order to achieve that goal, we will need a 3% improvement in energy productivity every year and a 1% decarbonization rate in energy supply each year. These are far greater than the historic rates between 1980 and 2014. I see the challenge of speeding up our energy transition as working harder and smarter. It will not be easy. However, it will be easier and preferable than coping with the more severe and very unpleasant negative consequences of runaway, out-of-control climate chaos. A non-fossil fuel, non-nuclear energy pathway will also provide the benefits of maintaining and stabilizing our planetary climate system, protecting our ecological health and public health, enhancing our energy, water, food security, and improving our economic well-being. What more specifically must we do? For the transportation sector, improvements in vehicle efficiency and design, shared autonomous service-based vehicles, in other words, mobility as a service, electrified vehicles with the electricity coming from, of course, renewable sources. For the electricity sector, deploying more renewable sources and other technologies like hydrogen and energy carrier derived from zero carbon sources or bioenergy, as long as it's harvested sustainably and doesn't compete with food production. Denmark is aiming to reach 100% renewably generated electricity by 2035 and 100% renewable energy in all sectors by 2050. Having an electric grid that is now more than 40% powered by renewables, Denmark's electricity supply is around 10 times more reliable than our country's electricity supply. Thanks a lot.
All right. All
right.
Okay, I want to see. Yeah. All right, I'm going to start keeping my own time.
Yeah. Charles Dudley Warner used to say, why is it everybody talks about the weather, but nobody does anything about it? I support the fight to do something about climate change. But at the same time, I was a freshman in high school when we had the first Earth Day in 1970. And at the teaching that was at Evanston Township High School, where I was a student, Dr. Roger Charlier, who was a professor at Northeastern at the time, was the keynote speaker. And he said that when mankind comes to an end, it's not going to come with a bang or with a whimper, but with a gasp. And, you know, we're still talking about this. And I hope that somebody, somewhere, including us, does something about it soon. We really need a grand effort like we did in the 1960s when we put men on the moon, put people on the moon. And we should do something about this now. I mean, they're talking about putting iron in the ocean. That's one of the most laughable things I've heard. That makes about as much sense as putting geritol in the ocean because it has, what is it? It has more iron than in a pound of calf's liver. Thank you.
When it comes to climate change, I am in agreement with our speaker. I am also in agreement with Dennis Nelson on the dangers of nuclear power and proliferation as it is currently practiced. The thing is, Dennis, the first commercial nuclear power reactor did not come on site until almost 1957. And right now it still is one of the biggest major components of our electric power infrastructure. I know a lot of people are saying that renewables will cut it. I'm afraid that that's not going to happen. As most of you know, I am a strong advocate of a liquid fluoride thorium reactor. That's a liquid base that uses fluoride salts that basically can eliminate the nuclear waste stream. That can radically change a lot of the infrastructure of how we generate power, and in strong combination with renewables is probably the only way we will get off of oil. Because you see, right now, the way we do nuclear is not the right way to do it. And this was even advocated by one of the co-designers of the existing light water reactor, Alvin Weinberg, who even started in the early 70s talking about global warming. He was fired out of his directorship of the Oak Ridge National Laboratories because he brought up the very concerns that you're bringing forth about nuclear power. But with him, he had a viable alternative. We have these reactors running, or we did in the 60s, One of them ran for close to 6,000 hours and is right now being extensively worked on by the Chinese. The China is going full bore into renewable research, hydroelectric research, and well over 300 scientists in perfecting this technology. Certain companies in the United States are saying that the current lifter commercialization is within 5 years, and that if built on an assembly line basis, we could have them.
Yeah.
Now, I'm not going to get into too much about how they work here, because you can find that readily online at the Thorium Energy Alliance. All I'm going to say is this. I'm not one of these guys who's crazy about nuclear power. I'm not one of these guys who's crazy about, you know, seeing the world being burned up through carbon change. But this is really, after a lot of thought and hard consideration, after attending the Thorium Energy Alliance conference, not twice, but three times over the last few years, speaking with some good, solid nuclear scientists who are in the field and doing the research, and also a personal association with John Kutch of the Thorium Energy Alliance out of Harvard, I think that I can speak with some authority saying that we should not close the door on nuclear power.
Yeah.
And Charlie, the only reason you say bullshit, you just are not enlightened, my friend.
Okay. And all right, your time.
Next.
Okay. Who's next? Anybody?
All right,
no,
go ahead.
Speakers. No. Yeah, what about you, David?
I spoke.
He did. Don't you?
All right, Don, go ahead.
Only a minute and a half.
Am I the only person other than the speaker? What about Charlie? Charlie, you want to talk?
Yeah, just a little bit.
Let's go, Charlie.
All right, let's thank our speaker once again.
Hey.
Thank you for speaking, and thank you for your efforts to save the planet. A lot of things we're in concurrence with you, but I can pick on you a little bit. I got to do a little something here. First of all, you did come as a secular speaker, but you are a man of religious persuasion. I was thinking about it. I don't think Christianity has a strong position. You can argue this if you like. A very strong ecological position, because it defines the world hierarchically. And the model, the eco model of paradigm, if you wish, is circular, meaning everything's related. And those two are incompatible, but the theology evolves, so that's no big deal. Now, the Asian religions, and I'd be guilty of wild generalizations, I think they're a little more fearful of the earth. They look upon it differently. Weather enters their heart, rain and snow and things like this, so they have a different perspective on weather, and particularly the earth. I think they're not as, like the Western culture is more of a, it's ours, let's get it and dig it and use it and burn it and whatever. And the Asians are more, let's wait a minute, let's see what we're dealing with here. So they have a totally more cautious view of nature. The American Indians, now the other ones, you hear a great deal about from time to time in the ecological movement, but that's just sort of a pantheism that, nobody can figure out Indian theology. I'm sorry, it's just whatever. I've tried and I've given up. It's nice, it sounds nice, it's poetic, but it's like a pantheism here. And there's also a string out there, I don't know if they're still around, the earth-based religions, they called it. I don't know if that terminology is still in use. That goes back any number of years. That's basically witchcraft. If you feel well, they use herbs and things like this, making potions. Now, Mike, my friend back there in the corner, are you awake? We had about, this is this level he's coming at you from. We had 100 to 200 representatives of all the countries of the earth get assembled, got together to sign. I've been in the UN Association for years, I know about these things, an international agreement of an issue of concern to everyone on the planet. And Mike says, well, we use some energy in order to save the planet. Now we had 200 people representing, what is it, 7 billion?
Hey,
people?
One fool at a time.
That's all right. Now, I guess
hey, Mike,
that's a quite a terrible expenditure of energy to send to. We could have had them walk there in order to satisfy Mike. But I don't think an expenditure, there's a trade-off in these things, you know. I'm trying to think of the terminology of cost effectiveness.
I think,
yeah, because so we did get 200 people, and they did burn a little energy in getting together, but I don't know if that's a real high price to pay for saving the planet from extinction. All right, thank you very much.
Okay. All right.
200 people out of billions.
Oh,
a big deal.
All right. Who else? Who else would like? All right. Who else wants to speak? Anybody?
Don, why don't you speak?
Okay, I will. All right. All right. All right. Tim, could you give me a 1 minute warning?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Thanks. All right. First of all, I thought this was a really good presentation. This is one of the best presentations I've seen on the subject of global warming. I will not call it climate change. I think that was a term popularized by the conservative political analyst Frank Luntz, who found that the term climate change didn't scare people as much as the term global warming in his focus groups, and so he advocated that global warming skeptics use the term climate change because it sounded, instead. And unfortunately, as I was telling some people before the program began, unfortunately, liberals and environmentalists immediately latched onto the term because never met a euphemism they didn't like. They tend to be of the view that, you know, they're anxious not to hurt anyone's. Liberals are nice people. They're anxious not to hurt anyone's feelings or offend anybody. So God forbid they should use that scary term global warming when climate change is so much nicer.
Oh,
yeah. So I didn't really feel like I got answered one question. I have to take issue with you on one thing. And it really seems to me like the number one opposition is coming from the United States, which really surprised me and it really saddened me because I do consider myself a patriotic American. But as I understand it, even China, which is actually more on board with stopping global warming than the United States now, China with a dictatorship government. As I understand it, you can correct me in your rebuttal when you get the final word if I'm wrong, but as I understand, even Russia, and I think you even mentioned the OPEC countries, are more on board with stopping global warming than the United States government. So I think this is something, as an American, I'm really ashamed of this. I feel that this is a disgrace to our country. We ought to be leading and not be in the last one, the last of 200 countries or so to get on board.
I'm not ashamed of the United States.
Okay. Well, now in response to what Mike said, global warming is not in the future. It's right now. And as for nobody being against air pollution, there are plenty of groups who are campaigning against air pollution, including one that I'm involved in, the Sierra Club. We have been campaigning to close coal burning power plants here in Illinois, in Chicago. I personally participated in the campaign to shut down these coal-fired plants.
And they still have all that fracking.
Right. Now, that's a separate issue. And by the way, one fool at a time, Charlie. 1 minute to go? Okay.
Yeah,
all right.
Yeah.
So, now, my... Tim was talking about thorium. My understanding, and I hope that we have time, My friend Ellen, who came here tonight, knows a lot more about thorium than I do. But I can tell you, you can speak if you want to on that, Ellen, but I'll just tell you what Ellen told me. She studied this a lot more than I did. She said that the thorium nuclear plant has never been really perfected, and it won't be for a long time. And to Charlie, what you were talking about, the history of religion, if you look at the map, all the major religions of the world started in Asia. Christianity, Judaism, Islam, but Israel and Arabia are actually on the Asian continent. So even the so-called Western religions actually started in Asia. All right, and with that, if there are no more rebuttal speakers. Another rebuttal speaker.
We got one. They're not part of Western civilization.
All right. You get the final word. Oh, wait.
No, we have another rebuttal speaker.
I'm sorry.
We got time.
Okay. No, that's fine.
Well, I thought that since somebody mentioned religion, I should contribute to that effort. I guess most of the religions do have sacrifices, and they do create fire and CO2 emission. I don't know whether the bramble bush with Moses had any CO2 emission, but it happened. The thing that I want to emphasize is that we cannot really separate climate change from pollution, water pollution, and other air pollution, and our environment deterioration, and the fact that if you cannot drink water from a river, I don't think you can breathe the air either, and it all changes our environment, and it goes hand in hand. So if we just separate only our CO2 emission without knowing the overproduction of trinkets, I think we are fooling ourselves. I remember when Chuck brought that good lecture on overproduction of trinkets, and he had best examples in here. And at that time, he didn't mention one word about waste and emissions that caused the overproduction of trinkets. And when I brought that one example, and keep this in mind, the best example, if you keep it in mind, you probably will have the environmental with you all the time, is the thing that I picked up in microbiology, and I'm going to bring it again, which I was left down by Chuck at that time, is the Petri dish. And the Petri dish gives us a good example. When we smear it with the bacteria will, in the medium, the bacteria will grow and grow, and all of a sudden it will stop. And of course, if I were to ask you the question, why does it stop? Why did the bacteria stop growing? And because they are wallowing in their own waste. Their own waste makes them stop growing. And that's what is going to happen to us. Now, at what point and when? But that's a dire prediction. Keep that in mind, the Petri dish.
All right. You guys are all looking at it.
Anybody else?
All right, any other rebuttal speakers? Did you want to speak? You spoke, never mind.
Yeah.
All right. Does anybody else want to give a rebuttal speech? We still have time for more people to talk.
Anybody else?
No? All right. Well, Mike already gave a rebuttal speech. Dr. Gallagher.
You get the last word.
It's your turn.
Yeah. You get the last word.
Yeah, you get the last word. Yeah. And you can go as long as, you can go until 8:45. You can go as long as you want to now.
Wow. Maybe sped up.
First of all, I want to thank you for inviting me and giving me the opportunity. It's not every day that we take the time to pause and reflect on where we're at as a society, and it's important to do so. None of us started out intentionally to destroy the earth. None of us decided that we're going to live our life in a way so that future generations could not survive. None of us did. Even the strongest fossil fuel advocate has to come up with things that they can tell themselves that are convinced that we're going to magically solve our problems when we get to it. But it's hard to face the reality that we screwed up royally. We really did. We founded the basis of our modern society on a system that requires the destruction of the life systems of the earth. That's very difficult for us to accept. It's very difficult for us to ponder. But ponder we must. And it's easy to give one hip shot response after another hip shot response. But in our heart of hearts, we know that the path we're on cannot be sustained. In our heart of hearts, in the dark coldness of the night, when we're lying awake, if we allow ourselves, we know that we have to change. Now we can argue about how to change and how fast to change and when we change. And we can't argue against the fact that we fundamentally have to change how we're organized as a society locally, nationally, and globally. When we are just numbering under a billion people, which was only a couple hundred years ago, okay, we could be separated across the globe and we could pretend the earth was flat. And we didn't have to worry about them people on the other side because the big sea monsters we eaten off before they came our way. And instead we created a society where within 2 weeks, our pollution is everybody's pollution. No matter where it's emitted, in 2 weeks, it's around the globe. Some countries, surprisingly, are ahead of us on this that you wouldn't think would be ahead of us. China. But the reason China is because they skipped the intermediate phase. We started burning fossil fuels, and we started choking on the exhaust that we were putting out. Right? I remember my mother hanging clothes on a line in Cleveland, and she could only hang them when the wind was out of the right direction, because otherwise the steel mill exhaust would come and the clothes would be dirtier hanging them out than with it. And so we entered a period of time where we required scrubbers to go on smokestacks, right? And so we eliminated some of the most gross pollution. And we pretended that the rest of that stuff wasn't harmful, right? Because we couldn't see it. We rely on our senses. We're still so not evolved as a human species. We rely on our senses. I remember as a chemical plant manager, I had hazardous chemicals that I called friendly hazardous chemicals, because they were so nasty you wouldn't stand in their presence. And so I had no trouble with employees putting on their personal protective equipment, because it hurt to be on. But I had other hazardous chemicals which were sweet smelling. And my employees would choose to not put their respirators on and their chemical equipment protections on because it's uncomfortable. Our human psyche is turned into, if I don't smell it, and it smells bad, if I don't taste it, and it tastes bad, if I don't feel it, then the hazard doesn't exist. We have to evolve to the point where we're relying on the science to tell us the hazard doesn't exist. And we've created it. And we've created it at a level that we're threatening the existence of human civilization. One of the things that we've done in the last 30 years, it happened while I was still in the chemical industry, is we moved from a long-term focus to a very short-term focus. All corporations are concerned about this quarter's results. They're actually concerned about the next 10 days, instead of 30 years or 40 years out. Somebody was raising Native Americans and the idea that we consider the seventh generation we make decisions. We have to move to basing our human civilization on both the rational and also on the heartfelt, the gut felt, the in my bowels felt. That human beings, even if they don't look like me, even if they're not yet born, living systems that I depend on are very necessary to continue. I cannot just consume them. I cannot use up all the resources. I cannot so pollute the earth that future generations do not have a chance to live. That's what we're faced with. That's the reality. We shy away from it. We didn't intend to do that, but we've done it. I do this work for my grandkids. I was supposed to be touring the country in a 40-foot motorhome in my retirement. I have two brothers that do that. Instead, I have hybrid cars, and I take them to talks that I give. Mike, I like your train card. I ride the train every time I go to D.C. to meet with Congress. We have to find a way to live with each other and with future generations. And it doesn't start 10 years from now. It has to start now. We have to find a way where we respect each other enough to give a damn. Thanks for having me.
All right.